See the animal in his cage that you built. Are you sure what set you? Better not look him too closely in the eye. Are you sure what's out of the glass you are? See the safety of the life you have built. Everything where it belongs. Feel the hollowness inside of your heart. And it's all right where it belongs. What if everything around you isn't quite as it seems? What if all the world you think you know is an elaborate dream? And if you look at your reflection, is that all you want to be? What if you could look right through the crowd? Would you find yourself afraid to see? What if all the world's inside of your head just creations of your own? The devils and your gods are the living and the dead. And you really are alone. You can live in this illusion. You can choose to believe. You keep looking, but you can't find the words. Are you hiding the truth? What if everything is uncut as it seems? What if all the world you used to know is an elaborate dream? If you look at your reflection, is that all you want to be? What if you could look right through the cracks? Would you find yourself afraid to see? Thank you.
So that was Right Where It Belongs by the great band Nine Inch Nails. And you can see in that song that the whole song is really the classic archetypal example of gaslighting. not in the pejorative, highly negative sense that the word is often used as today, which I don't like very much. Although obviously it can be very negative, and I use it in that way too. But in that song, Trent Reznor is asking us to really take a whole new look on ourselves, our existence, in the most amazing and beautiful way. And asking us to question our own sense of reality. And the implication in that song is that our reality is very much over-circumscribed and while we may think we're free and that it's other people who are in cages, in fact we are very much caged in many ways, and perhaps most of all by our own limited view of reality. And the stifling and limiting nature of the socially accepted reality and the mass reality. So, this is really the vibe and the direction that I'm really trying to inculcate in whoever reads my book, whereby questioning one's own reality and sense of reality is not seen in a defensive way, although one does in fact need to defend against being called crazy in our society, as I've had to defend myself, as I'm defending myself now, but in a strange, quite strange way, which could get me into more trouble. That it shouldn't be seen purely in an offensive way, but that those amongst us who aim for higher goals and more noble goals, who aim for real philosophy, should be open to the idea of looking at reality anew to such an extent that we really do question our own sanity and the sanity of those around us. And the idea is that this is what true philosophy, has always been and really is. And hopefully, this isn't something which is restricted, like I say, to, the ivory tower or just a few, so-called philosophers. But something that can become more just to a certain extent can be introduced more to society in general, where people have a more humble and Socratic approach to reality in themselves, whereby they become aware of their own insanity. And adopt a more circumspect and questioning approach to the world, which hopefully will prevent them from being so quick to label others as crazy and jump to conclusions about, usually very false conclusions, about what is reality and the correct view of the world. And you see this is seems a very particularly important or potentially healthy message to get out today, where you have very fanatical belief systems arising on both the left and the right of the political spectrum, where people are particularly out of the habit of questioning their own perspective on reality. And they're more interested in simply attacking the supposed opposite side of the spectrum. Reality is descending into, society is descending more into ideological warfare than a true quest for truth and ideas. So this book of mine is positioning myself right in between the two poles in a way, and going very much against the currents, swimming very much against the tides in that respect, and trying to make a place for real philosophy and questioning in a world which has in a way vacated the space for such questioning of philosophy. So I feel that I'm filling a void to a certain extent in that respect. And so again, hopefully that explains the intimate connection I see between my two fields of interest here, which is on the one hand mental illness and madness, and on the other philosophy. So that is the title of my book, Gaslit by a Madman. And as I was just beginning to explain in my last video, that is actually literal in referring to my own experience, because I was in fact sectioned about 13 years ago against my will and with absolutely catastrophic consequences for me. So there's a lot about that in my book. And in the title, I am, you know, I'm throwing the accusation back on the doctor who had me sectioned and calling him a madman. because, you know, that is actually my honest opinion, you know, that the psychiatric profession is highly unscientific. It's pseudoscience, and the kind of valuations and so-called diseases or disorders which they pretend to deal in are actually very, very delusional themselves, very unhealthy, and they do an enormous amount of damage to people. So really, this whole profession of psychiatry and those who endorse it are, in a very real sense, you know, they are mad and out of control and dangerous. You know, that they are, you know, functional in a certain narrow sense. You know, they conform to society's own requirements, and they've obviously managed to study and jump through the hoops that society sets people to achieve a sense of propriety or a veneer of propriety. But from a higher point of view, you know, if society itself can be subject to criticism and weighed against a higher sense of truth and justice and sanity, as philosophy generally has done, you know, with starting with Socrates, perhaps, whereby the philosopher subjects society itself to intellectual, logical, and moral criticism. if that sort of thing is allowed to be carried out, then it would seem that psychiatry is, by the standard of the actual truth, as opposed to its own standard or the standard society, is very suboptimal, to put it nicely, and it's actually doing great harm to people and very counterproductive, and the exact sort of so-called scientific explanations and claims that it makes are in fact false and therefore highly delusional, which is the standard criteria set by psychiatrists themselves for psychosis and mental illness. So it's my claim that both by their own criteria, you know, looked at from a more objective point of view, and also just from reality itself, psychiatry is in fact crazy. if we look at, you know, society historically, we do in fact perceive that what was socially acceptable, you know, hundreds of years ago or thousands of years ago, is in fact, you know, by today's standards, highly immoral, highly raw, very wrong, based on illusions, delusions, false beliefs, and in fact, you know, in many respects, crazy. So the idea that that should be true of our own society nowadays is not a particularly implausible claim from, you know, a wider, more philosophical, historical point of view. It's, you know, but then it's simply the fact that the almost by definition, a society at a certain time will not think that itself is crazy and will not own up to its own mistakes and be self-critical to that extent. So it would be, you know, absolutely no surprise if what I'm saying is not entirely the commonly received perspective on the issue, because society is always, you know, criticizing its previous societies or criticizing its own past, but it doesn't take the logic to its full conclusion and apply it to itself. But instead, it, you know, it arrogantly assumes that it has now reached the what is in his historicist or Heideggerian terms, it's reached kind of the, or Hegelian terms, sorry, it's reached the absolute moment whereby, you know, it has a somewhat overly optimistic view of itself and considers itself to be perfectly in the right. And merely criticizes the past. But then the future, you know, 10, 50, or 100 years down the line, it will look back and say, well, no, in fact, you know, your time was wrong too. You know, you were also great injustices, which you were not dealing with as much as you should have, and that kind of thing. So, you know, it's inevitably, the trend continues, and criticism is allowed in hindsight, but it can be dangerous at the moment, in the present. And, you know, these are very important ideas to assimilate, to really, really take deep into one's soul. And by doing that, one begins to overcome them and get ahead of the trend to a certain extent, whereby one does become more critical of one's own time, one's own received opinions, one's grown up with, and one's own climate. And thereby achieve a higher level of consciousness and justice. And, you know, that involves, in other words, questioning whether one itself is crazy and whether the people around one are crazy. You know, it's a heightened level of self-doubt and self-criticism. Which, you know, fits in perfectly with the title of my book. Because, you see, the title works both ways. It's not just me being accused of being crazy by a bad doctor or a mad doctor, but also, you know, me being bold enough to to gaslight society, to question the sanity of society. Is that probably already made clear from what I've said? And it's in fact somebody who has been accused of being a madman, questioning the sanity of society. So it's turning the accusation back on them, which is a very bold thing in a way, because, you know, I suppose philosophers generally have enough trouble being listened to and getting society to heed their critiques under the best of circumstances, right? When they're considered somewhat respectable members of society and haven't already been accused of being crazy. No, they then may tend to be accused of being crazy afterwards or persecuted in other ways. But that's then usually perhaps a slightly gradual process and comes as a result of what they say and their philosophy. Whereas in my case, it's more laughable situation in which I have already been accused of simply, you know, having a serious mental illness and being insane, and then trying to purvey my philosophy on the back of that. So I play out the situation, right? You know, I don't try and disguise it or hide from it, which would be a futile and even more laughable thing to do. But instead, I embrace it and play it up and celebrate it, because, you know, like I say, rather than being a mark of shame and an objection to a philosopher and the works of philosophy, rather than being an objection, the accusation of crazy or being very much at loggerheads with society is the norm and in fact the standard of real philosophy. So, you know, I play that up and I celebrate it. And by doing so, I hope that I can draw attention and actually spread insight and enlightenment over this crucial crux of what philosophy is and what it means. And thereby open up more and more people's minds and convert potential philosophers. So, you know, so you see, it is both a danger and a great calamity in many ways, but also from a certain perspective, it's an opportunity, represents an opportunity. So you see, I hope this is clear now, that this title has this, you know, this dual meaning, and it's, you know, it's perfectly symmetrical in a double sense. It's you know, there's a fourfold significance there, if you grasp what I'm saying. The concept of madness, in fact, appears four times in those in those four words. I mean, that gives, it gives it a nice balance, I think. I'm both entertaining the accusation of that I'm crazy, and at the same time I'm, you know, trying to refute it and turn it back on society. So it's not a, it's not a, I know, I don't know, it's not a one-sided sort of title which asserts a certain case exactly, but it's something that creates a kind of balance and a weighing scale kind of image in the mind. So I suppose what I'm going to do is I'm going to be reading from the book, probably reading the book in its entirety, and at the same time giving commentary, you know, on it and expanding what it's about. Because I don't instinctively and naturally make my writings totally transparent and upfront and clear. You know, I think that's a bit patronizing. You know, I like to, you know, put some kind of deeper meanings, you know, elusive kind of meanings, and you know, so the readers have to kind of read between the lines to a certain extent rather than spelling it all out, which I think is, you know, patronizing. And you know, if people cannot read between the lines a little bit, and by way of kind of sympathy, get into the heart of what it's about, then maybe the message shouldn't be totally explicit and spelled out, because some people are just looking to you know, to tear you down, unjustifiably, based on a shallow and superficial view of them, view of the matters. Although I'm sure, you know, from reading this book, there'll be loads of ammunition and potential for people to tear me down, you know, whatever the case. But it quit, you know, it's this is you know, what Leo Strauss talked about, you know, in his writing, you know, that you can create an intimacy with the reader by holding things back a little bit at times, or writing in a slightly artful way, you know, which is what poetry is about to a large extent, and what gives that its charm. It's a kind of way of being slightly cryptic in a way that creates a direct telepathy with the author's mind, rather than spelling everything out in a somewhat gauche and you know, artless way. So, I mean, yeah, so the book is actually split into, you know, the first 100 pages, in fact, are poetry, because that's how I started recovering from the trauma that had been inflicted upon me by psychiatry. I think, as I say in the book, I think writing poetry is a very good way of just beginning to put one's thoughts in order and express one's feelings to the world in a way that, to a certain extent, it brackets them as a work of art, perhaps, so that what doesn't totally identify with them and consider them, you know, an objective truth, which may be a bit hasty when one's mind is still in a formative state or a state of chaos due to perhaps trauma that has been inflicted upon it. Yes, but so that it can begin to actually put some order to that chaos in a way that's a bit more non-committal. It also is a great and traditional kind of avenue for expressing one's kind of pain and one's personal pain, coming to terms with that. And it also highlights and privileges the individual soul and the personal soul, the person's soul. In a way that, you know, prose may not do so to such an extent. And, you know, by doing that, by highlighting the personal soul, that actually may begin to get oneself some kind of the attention and sort of love, genuine love, because reading a poetry really is an act of love. And the kind of sensitivity that one is looking for and one feels one has been denied in the past, the kind of respect and sensitivity that is actually extremely important and conducive to real healing. Because the individual human soul and the mind is always a thing of that deserves the most extreme reverence. You know, when you are looking at another human being, looking to their soul, or how one regards oneself, that should always be, you know, like a temple, or, you know, an act of love and extreme respect and reverence. I mean, obviously in our day-to-day lives, and at times it can't always be like that, and it shouldn't necessarily always be like that, but there is that aspect to it, and that should always be somewhere beneath the surface, we see that divine aspect in one another. And it seems, you know, that is often so sadly lacking in society. But at least in, you know, the realm of art and poetry, this kind of, you know, communion with the more sacred aspect of human beings is something which is presenced and highlighted. And it's extremely important that we preserve this manner of looking things and doing things for the sake of our future. I mean, I think I'd really like to talk a little bit more about this subject now, in fact, because although there's a lot more to talk about, and it's a bit off topic. But you know, it seems to me that there's a lot of fake respect and you know, substitute respect in society for individuals, you know, or rather, you know, not as individuals, but by virtue supposedly of their membership of a certain, you know, marginalized or persecuted group. So the it's respect and reverence, which is rightfully due the individual and the individual soul, is instead being displaced and substituted onto one's identity as part of some kind of supposedly, you know, oppressed group. And it seems to me that this is an inherently patronizing, insulting, and profane way of going about things, because it's not one's membership in some kind of proverbial, you know, classification, it's a societal classification that gives one's one's, you know, great worth and dignity and value as a human being. In fact, these are just extremely distorting and demeaning labels that reduce one to, you know, statistic. And some kind of extremely shallow societal marker that abstracts entirely from the living presence of the human mind and spirit. So it's completely counter to true respect and true dignity and true reverence for the human being and our own humanity. In fact, rather than getting irate and at each other's throats about our so-called deserving respect to some kind of member of some kind of oppressed group, we should be, you know, highlighting the inherent dignity and worth of each individual and each individual soul. and if we did that, it would be totally superfluous, unnecessary to highlight our dignity or our respect, you know, due to us as a certain member of a certain proverbial group. And probably we would be much less irate and much less at each other's throats, because we would then be getting, in fact, what we really secretly want and really deserve, which is the respect and reverence due to us in virtue of our own individuality, our own personhood, our own selves. It seems like it's not a coincidence that the more we generalize and talk about ourselves in these tribalistic fitting into certain group terms, the more we do that, then the more irate and at each other's throats as a society we become. And the general and the extent to which the general blood pressure of society has risen, and the spirituality goes down. It doesn't seem like it's just a coincidence. It seems like these things are directly feeding into one another. So yes, as I was saying, you know, the first 100 pages of my book is poetry, and that helped me during my own recovery process. And I encourage other people to adopt it in general, and for it to be more a part of works of philosophy and works of art in general. This mixture, which doesn't conceal the more emotional and personal aspect of thought, but rather highlights it. And thereby it reaffirms the wholeness of our nature. And then there's about 300 or 400 pages after that, which is intended as philosophy of some kind. But it's a highly, quite a highly strange type of philosophy in that, the most normal aspect of it, a way of describing it, would be that it's, you know, inspired by Nietzsche, in that there's a lot of aphorisms in his style, but with my own style kind of thrown in as well. And and it is intended to some extent as genuine insightful philosophy and shedding light on the world. but then it's also it's very much a product of the trauma that I sustained from psychiatry, and it's very much a type of therapy which, you know, conveys only a snapshot of how I was when I wrote it. And, you know, as I mature and process my experiences more and more, the way I would express myself will change. And I think that's an important aspect of real philosophy, in that it conveys a feeling of life, not just abstract thought. Conveys the type of life for the person who wrote it, and that's what my writing, my book tries to do. But because of the intense agony that I was in during the last 10 or 12 years due to psychiatry, it's very unlike a lot of philosophy, because it's a real howl against, you know, society and against the profession that did this to me. And, you know, it's a raw sore and gaping wound of agony in many respects. So, you know, that's going to make it very controversial, and because it levels a lot of accusations against others, because, you know, I myself was so demeaned and accused of being crazy, and I was in such pain. That pain is expressed as a complaint and accusation against society, and it really does border the line between, you know, genuine, you know, truth and philosophy, and on the other hand, simply being a kind of work of art or work of therapy. It's not always clear, you know, which it is. Because sometimes, you know, the truth or the philosophy will be the way in which it manifests will be so you know, colored by the trauma and the pain involved, that it won't seem very much like abstract thought or you know, abstract philosophy. And you know, I do stand by most of the ideas in the book. You know, I think there's a lot of truth in them, or that they will shed light on a certain perspective of the issue. But on the other hand, it's very important to emphasize that it's only, you know, a snapshot or a certain perspective, which I felt was suitable to form a sort of a somewhat cohesive work of art, which manifests and presences the state that I was in when I wrote it, or I'll say that I had been in for the, you know, the preceding years. You know, I'm very much in favor of, you know, full freedom of expression and freedom of speech. And that is testified to in this book. And I'm, you know, I have a very negative and critical attitude of, you know, recent attempts to curtail that freedom of speech. I think Jordan Peterson is doing great work, you know, in promoting that issue. But I would tend to go even further. On the other hand, you know, I'm not trying to, you know, make myself a martyr and getting more in trouble with the authorities. So if I have overstepped the line in any respect on that issue, it's simply through not knowing where to draw the line, because these laws are so inherently blurry, and you know, my ignorance on that subject. And I do not advise people to go outside the law. On the other hand, we have to try and press the law as far as it will go, as far as it will let us, lest, you know, these restrictions on freedom of expression become even more and more severe. You know, it's my intention to always draw back when notified. So I may have to take some things out of this book in future editions, which is very sad. But you know, it's probably better that way. So I mean, yes, I would urge people to approach it, you know, with that in mind, that it is a work of therapy, but I don't like the strict separation of therapy from ordinary life, or the strict separation of therapy from philosophy, or these other artificial distinctions. Rather, you know, I see it as being both, and philosophy I interpret as being, you know, inherently a type of therapy itself. So I hope people would not dismiss it intellectually because it contains an aspect of therapy and personality in it. But at the same time, I would hope that people would see the philosophy and the ideas as in a sympathetic light, as the product of an extremely suffering soul at the time, whose suffering was in fact inflicted upon it. I consider this to be the right way of looking at, you know, at everything, at people in general and what they do, and the art of the tracks they produce. You know, we should always see people as human beings, as fallible, and you know, in a sympathetic light as possible. We shouldn't be too hasty to judge, particularly when dealing with individuals. I see this as being even more true in my case, because, you know, I was in such a dire torment. But I'm not making excuses, because I don't think I've done anything. I don't think I've said anything wrong, you know, or done anything wrong. It's just the climate of the times makes it dangerous to do what is right, you know, in my opinion, you know, because, you know, words, in fact, you know, don't hurt people, you know, I feel that, as I say in the book, that it's much more important in general to foster an environment of openness and therapy, because that is what real therapy is about. It's not about repressing and palatable ideas. Anyway, this video has gone on too long now. I need to end it. Although I'm kind of in the middle of a point here, but. I'm gonna end it here, because I like to stick to a schedule on this. It's around 55 minutes, and I'll probably continue this point later if I don't pick up immediately in the next lecture. Thanks so much.